In the animal kingdom, there are about 1.5 million species. And to classify them scientifically, each of those creatures requires two names consisting of genus and species. That means a lot of naming. As we've seen in the previous episode, such a formidable undertaking requires a special lexicon. And it's very important to learn that lexicon in order to be fluent and to be able to converse in the language of this area of study. There are many terms that are specific to the field of zoology for anatomical structures, physiological processes, ecological interactions, behavioral syndromes, to name a few. You need to know the language of zoology to be able to speak and engage with others in the field of zoological science. It's kind of like attempting to describe the activities and objects in a kitchen without mentioning a fridge, stove, sink, oven, measuring spoons, spatula, blender, ingredients, water, heat, food, and all the other factors that go into it. Without knowing and being able to say any of those key terms, you really can't describe the workings of a kitchen, because it requires specialized terminology. The same is true for branches of science, whether it's botany, genetics, molecular sciences, or, as we're looking at in the case of this course, zoology. And so, given the vast number of creatures covered by zoology, this area of study has an immense lexicon of its own that we need to learn in order to be zoological scientists. Here we have a word cloud generated from the keywords list of the jellyfish chapter on cnidaria. Given that this is just one chapter of 18, each with its own lexicon of specialized terms to know, it can seem daunting to imagine ever learning them all. This is especially the case when scientific terms are so often large and made up of strange-looking components, like strobilization, mesoglia, and dioecious, for example. However, upon closer inspection, we will note that we can usually recognize some parts of the words, if not the entire word at first, such as hydrozoa, which contains hydro for water and zoa for animals. Think of a zoo or zoology, for example. Then we can note the same roots in other words like cubozoa, the square-shaped jellyfish animals. In other places, we may be able to deduce some meaning from parts of the words, like endodermis and ectodermis, which also resemble the term epidermis. Most of us will already know that epidermis refers to skin, just like with dermatologists. So endo and ectoderms must be inside and outside layers of the skin. The point is that, as you can see, there is a very large lexicon, and you do need to learn it. But, fortunately, there's a means by which to learn this by recognizing the structure and content of the words, rather than just memorizing them as collections of meaningless syllables. So what we've noticed is that there are subsets of these words that we're already familiar with. Ones that we've seen elsewhere in our own personal lexicons. And we're capable of matching them to some of these units that are found in these words. And that is very important because it's essentially the nature of scientific terminology that the word is meant to describe the object or action that it is representing. So this nomenclature of scientific terminology, particularly the nomenclature that goes into zoology and the naming of organisms, includes the names of the parts or the processes as being embedded directly into the official structure of scientific language. And it goes back to this guy, Guiton de Morveau, who basically set out the rules for scientific nomenclature in that it should be descriptive in nature, meaning that the words should describe what the word represents. It's also important to use dead languages, meaning we're using Latin and ancient Greek, not contemporary Greek, and there's a very good reason for that. Dead languages, just like extinct animal species, such as this T-Rex, are no longer evolving.
And so there wouldn't be any contemporary or nuanced interpretation that could change the meaning of that word, and thus change the description of the animal that we're trying to describe with that word. By using dead languages, the meaning is more or less set in stone, and therefore there wouldn't be any ambiguity about what the root of that word is meant to represent. So let's use an example to see how this all plays out. Let's use a common scientific term that we're all pretty familiar with, photosynthesis. So photosynthesis can be broken down into two main root units, photo and synthesis, and then synthesis can be recognized as a contraction of two other root units, syn and thesis, which basically means putting something together, like so. The term photo is Greek for light. So therefore, photosynthesis basically means putting something together using light. So the scientific term provides definitional information about the meaning of the word itself, as well as its use in the scientific context. So this is essentially the etymological approach to looking at scientific terminology and recognizing that there's an underlying logical structure to the construction of these words based on root units in ancient Greek and Latin that provide them with meaning. And so in knowing this, it allows us to truly understand the meaning of these terms and to be able to apply them in the context of our study, rather than trying to memorize a jumble of letters and then having to regurgitate them back when we're asked to put them in the context of a classroom discussion or on an exam, for example. That's important, because knowing the roots of the words will allow you to engage with the material in a meaningful form of learning, to understand the definition of the word and its potential uses. Whereas memorization generally does not lead to meaningful forms of learning. So what am I talking about when I say meaningful forms of learning? Well, in educational circles, we typically refer to this.
This triangular structure is known as Bloom's taxonomy. It demonstrates how we aim to achieve the higher levels of learning, cognitive thought, or thinking, if you will, in our students in the process of teaching them, in the sense that the lower levels of remembering and understanding are the most basic forms of knowing the information. But it's not a very meaningful form of learning, because it does not allow you to apply that information, either to analyze it or to use it in other contexts. And so that's why, when we aim to teach at the university, we aim to achieve the higher levels of cognitive processes, such as evaluating, and even at some point, creating your own knowledge once you become master's and doctoral graduate students in your own right. But in the meantime, we want to promote a meaningful type of learning that allows students to get access to the information, to be able to retain that information, and to transfer it to other contexts, which essentially means making that information usable so you can apply it to the field of study and to make those words and to make that terminology meaningful in that context. Now, one of the problems about this sort of etymological approach is that it's based on preliminary understandings of classical linguistics. In other words, the language spoken by these folks. There was a time, even up to about 30 or 40 years ago, when classical linguistics were a part of even a basic university program. Latin and ancient Greek were prerequisites for entry into many university studies, and that is no longer the case. In fact, we now find that with the current generations of students, very few of them have any exposure whatsoever to the official study of classical linguistics, which would suggest that they are at a disadvantage at being able to apply this etymological understanding to the scientific terminology. But I would like to counter that by suggesting that through my teaching and learning strategies, that the lexical access through an understanding of the etymology is a useful tool that's available to contemporary students of science. So, as an example, when we're talking about zoology in the study of fish, we will see that there is a subsection, a class of fish known as Sarcopterygii. like this coelacanth latimeria, whose lineage goes back about 400 million years. To contrast with the more common actinopterygii, like this barracuda. When we see these words, at very first glance, they seem like they're a very strange jumble of letters that are almost meaningless and unrecognizable. But by using an etymological approach, which involves deconstructing a word into its root units, then identifying those root units by matching them to other terms that we are already familiar with, and then reconstructing the term, that allows us to understand its meaning, and therefore we can apply it to our field of study. So, using this term sarcopterygii as an example, it can be broken down into two main root units, sarco and pteron, as the singular for pteri, as well as the suffix gi, which just means that it has something. But what does having a sarcopteron actually mean? So this organism has a sarco-something, and the question then is, can we try to figure out other words that contain the same roots? We may mention a sarcophagus, for example, which is a kind of coffin to decompose dead bodies, i.e. flesh-eating, or perhaps we could think of a sarcomere, a piece of tissue or muscle. So sarco must refer to tissue, flesh, or muscle. Turning to pteron, we note that it is quite ubiquitous in scientific terms. The ferns are pteridophytes, meaning plants with winged leaves. Flies are diptera, or two-winged insects. But we also use this term often in our everyday lives, such as with the word helicopter, with its helix wing that spins on itself. So here we've figured out that pteron must mean wing, or in this case, a fin, since we're talking about a fish. Putting it all back together, we find that sarcopterygii means to have fleshy or muscular fins, and it refers to the articulated fins in these fish that allow them to waddle out onto shorelines and also give rise to amphibian descendants who would further adapt those muscular limbs into legs. By knowing the etymological makeup of scientific terms, it allows us to have insight into the structural and functional meaning of the word and to directly apply that knowledge to an understanding of the field of study. From now on, you will never need to memorize sarcopterygii, but you will know that it is a special group of fish that includes air-breathing mudskippers, as well as the ancestors for all terrestrial tetrapods to come. So once we know that the etymological approach allows us to decipher the meaning of the name itself provides a structure and functional information about the use of that name in the study itself. And in this process, we now know that an etymological approach to learning scientific terminology not only allows us to identify organisms with their name, but it also allows us to understand where they fit into the ecological and evolutionary story, due to the structure and functional information that the name itself provides. And by going through this process, we eliminate the requirement to memorize that rote technique that is not useful for meaningful learning. If we understand the root words and the reasons for the names, we will remember them forever.
So I use this etymological approach commonly throughout this course, mostly because it helps to reduce the burden of learning such a large lexicon. Also, it provides you with a learning scaffold, which is essentially a mental structure that you can use to apply to other situations that you're yet to encounter in your future learning. Also, it will provide you with an ability to learn independently, which is really one of the skills that we want to impart in our students, so that you can continue to learn on your own using the scaffolds that we gave you. It can be particularly useful because this approach is also broadly applicable to other fields in science. Botany, genetics, cell biology, for example, they all follow the same rules of nomenclature and etymology for the structure and function of their own terminology. And particularly from the perspective of the students, it can be very helpful in reducing the cognitive load associated with having to learn all those terms. I like to say, never memorize a thing. Learn it, understand it, and know it, and then you'll know it forever. That's true empowerment. And with a knowledge scaffold to build from, you'll never have to worry about becoming like this guy